Great opportunity, man. Great opportunity.
Focus! 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 Focus!
Now, love all you got. This is the play hard.
A last chance of the season to excel and reach past the obstacles to lay it all on the line.
Edwards cuts it up. Cuts it inside. Brings it back for a touchdown.
Today, Ole Miss, West Virginia. A coaching legend rides off into the sunset. Can Don Nealon and the Mountaineers snap an 8-game bowl losing streak? Or will Deuce McAllister and the Rebels ruin his swan song? Ole Miss battles West Virginia in the Music City Bowl. Next.
In Nashville, Tennessee, there's a song to be heard on almost every street corner. Today, Don Nealon takes the reins for the final time at West Virginia, his team arriving just a few moments ago. Meanwhile, out of the SEC comes the Mississippi Rebels. They are riding a current 4-game winning streak in bowl games, hoping to stretch that to 5 today. It's Ole Miss out of the SEC against the Big East, West Virginia Mountaineers. It's coming up next. Right now, back to the studio with Rod and Chris.
I kind of like that checkerboard Stratocaster the guy was playing. I appreciate that. We'll get to this game in just a second. But first of all, reminder, at halftime, we'll have further news. There are no arrests, no suspensions, and so far, no shortage of spin doctoring on the altercation that took place last night on Bourbon Street between some Miami and some Florida players. At halftime, we'll hear from both coaches, Spurrier and Davis, about this. Meanwhile, this ball game, it is the final college game for Deuce McAllister, and while he'd certainly like to win one for Ole State U, there's another motivation. He wants to show that when healthy, he can be a truly dominant NFL player and a top 2 or 3 draft pick.
Yeah, what did you call it? A contract game. I think you're right. It's a contract game for him. And why? Think about the fact that he missed 9 quarters of play this season. When you're a top pick, you can't miss that kind of time. He's had a shoulder injury, an ankle injury. He wants to show the scouts that he's back. He's real. He's ready to play.
All right. Meanwhile, throughout this first half, we'll update you on the Humanitarian Bowl. Boise State leading UTEP at this point over on ESPN2. And coming up later on ESPN tonight, it's Antonio Bryant, the Biletnikoff Award winner, and the Pittsburgh Panthers against Iowa State. Passing attack of Pittsburgh, ground attack, balanced attack of the Cyclones at 7:30 Eastern time. But up next, Deuce McAllister, a couple touchdowns against Oklahoma in the bowl game last year, wants more against West Virginia. It's next.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of the 2000 Music City Bowl is presented by Music City USA. Have you been to Nashville lately? And in part by 1010-220. Dial it and talk up to 20 minutes for only 99 cents. And by Red Zone from Old Spice. Intense protection for intense people. Nashville, Tennessee, music defines the landscape. Each chorus, each refrain, each melody has a special story to it. Today, the story centers around that man, Don Nealon, the head coach of West Virginia University. Today is his final game at the school, as he also tries to compose the final few bars of a long and distinguished coaching career. It's the first meeting ever. Ole Miss at 6-5, West Virginia Mountaineers. Hello, everybody. I'm Mark Jones. From all of us at ESPN, to all of you at home, all the best in the upcoming new year and a belated Merry Christmas. Now, the big story coming into this game is Don Nealon. After 338 games, 21 seasons at West Virginia as its head coach, today is his final game. It's one of the biggest stories of the year, actually, in college football. He's hoping to compose just the right song so that perhaps Gino Toretta, his team, can go platinum, maybe even double platinum against Ole Miss. But we have an interesting contrast of styles today, don't we?
And you'd think West Virginia winning 2 of their last 3 would be coming into this game on a high note. But their coach is retiring after 21 years. Only one assistant has been retained. Some of the younger players, unclear who's going to lead them in the future. Ole Miss is like a fine-tuned orchestra. Romero Miller, the school's all-time passing leader, has lots of weapons around him, and Deuce McAllister and Ben Heard at wide receiver. So look for Ole Miss to have a big game, Mark.
And you know, West Virginia, meanwhile, trying to snap an 8-game bowl losing streak. And for more on the West Virginia Mountaineers, let's go downstairs to Rob Stone.
Well, Mark, Coach Nealon ready to croon a new tune today. That's right. After 21 seasons of conservative, straight-ahead Mountaineer football, Coach has selected today as the day to experience the other side of the offensive playbook.
you know, this is our last game. We haven't won a bowl game. They're heavily favored to beat us, and they, you know, so we're just going to have some fun out there a little bit. Probably when you should be running, we probably will be passing, and probably when you should be passing, we may be running, and maybe when we should be punting, we may be doing something else, too. Who knows?
Last game, and not only is he still playing head games, but he's also been able to push aside that emotion and focus on leaving a winner.
Don Nealon, Rob, one of the most colored and decorated coaches in college football. And college football's coaching fraternity will certainly miss him when he is gone. Meanwhile, on the other side of the field, Coach David Cutliffe in his second full season at Ole Miss. This is his third bowl game, 16-8 overall. And a win today would mean consecutive 8-4 seasons for him. He hit the ground running when he took this program over a couple of years ago. This is the first meeting ever between these two teams. West Virginia has won the toss, deciding to defer. Mississippi will receive. That is number 22, Deuce McAllister, back deep, along with Robert Williams. Todd James kicking off for the Mountaineers as we are set to rock. And with a wind at his back, this one travels through the back of the end zone. And Ole Miss will start off on its own 20-yard line. The starting quarterback, Romero Miller, 6'1", 195. The only quarterback in school history to throw for over 2,000 yards twice in his career in a season. Now look at the skill positions. We talked about Deuce McAllister, but they are talented all around, Gino.
And Graham Hurd, the school's all-time receptions leader. They have lots of talent at the skill positions on offense.
First down and 10 from the 20. Stackhouse and McAllister lining up out of the eye in the backfield. McAllister off tackle, and he's stocked up right near the line of scrimmage. Let's take a look at the offensive front for the Rebels.
And Ben Claxton there getting the start. He broke his leg in the first game this season. He's coming back from injury. They may rotate Matt Kuhn in there also at the center position.
Up front, it's Davis, Upchurch, and Lake, meanwhile, for the Mountaineers. Davis, 6'5", 290, a sophomore, one of the guys to watch. McAllister now out, flanked out. They'll move him around a lot. Stackhouse, the lone back, flags down to the play. And McAllister runs it out to the 25-yard line. Brought down by Sean Hackett, the strong safety. Our referee today, Courtney Mazzi Jr.
Offside on the defense.
Let's take a look at the linebackers for the Mountaineers. And look, 3-4 alignment, Gino, a little different.
Mark, look out for Grant Wiley, who's the Big East Rookie of the Year. Chris Edmonds, it says he's a linebacker, but he is their rush linebacker. He's going to be putting pressure on the quarterback.
And Sean Hackett, one of the guys to watch in the secondary, a big hitter out of Trenton, New Jersey.
And the group as a whole, 19 interceptions combined in that secondary.
Second down and 5. Little motion on the right side of the offensive line by Ole Miss that time. Sanford gets the handoff, but they'll whistle this one dead, and Ole Miss will give back some of that penalty yardage that they received just a few minutes ago. Look at the numbers, 18 touchdowns to 12 interceptions for Miller this season. He has gotten healthier, though, in the last few weeks.
And he has lots of weapons around him. He's the school's all-time passing leader, but the man who makes this offense click, if he has a good game, Ole Miss will have a good game, because you know Deuce McAllister is going to show up, and you know their star wide receiver Grant Hurd is going to show up.
Back to second down and 10. McAllister and Sanford lining up out of the eye. There's McAllister running off tackle over the right side, brought down at the 25, so he gets back to 5 yards on that run, stopped up that time by Jason Davis, number 90. There's Davis, an explosive talent with good instincts at the end spot.
And Mark, what we're seeing here early by Ole Miss is lots of different formation variations. They want to see how West Virginia is going to adjust so they can create their game plan for later on as the game progresses.
Third down and 5. Miller, that's where he can hurt you, and he scrambles for the first down at the 32-yard line. And the Rebels strike first in the first down department.
It's a simple two deep. There you see a four-man front for West Virginia. Look at the hole that Miller has a chance to run through. He sees the man coverage underneath, able to escape and pick up the first down.
And that's part of the reason, Gino, why they've only given up 7 sacks on the season, because he's so mobile and agile back there. McAllister and Stackhouse in the offset eye on first down and 10. Miller fires incomplete, intended for number 14, L.J. Taylor. Miller completing 55% of his passes on the season coming into this game, a 3-year starter.
And the coaches say he has great command of this offense. He's a very confident player, and they're very confident in him. And that goes when a player and a quarterback especially is experienced, he's a senior, that changes your game plan. It allows you to open things up a little bit, especially in a bowl game.
Yeah, he has really grown into the position. Sanford, the lone back, on second down and 10. Quick three-step drop, it's complete. That's Grant Hurd. Brought down at the 38-yard line. Hackett, a strong safety, making the tackle.
There you see only 7 sacks allowed by Ole Miss. Attribute that to the whole offense. The offensive line does a good job, but we just watched Romero Miller. He saw the blitz that West Virginia showed. He audibled, able to get a quick pass off to Hurd, picks up good key yardage.
Sets up a third down and about 2 to go. And this the Rebels' opening drive of the ballgame. The toss is to Deuce McAllister. And he is close to the first down, appears to be just a little bit short. Tackled that time by Grant Wiley, number 6. The top freshman in the conference.
Ole Miss goes on a wing formation to the left. But look at the front 7 for West Virginia. They stalemate the Ole Miss offensive line and don't let McAllister run loose.
Into punt now is Reagan King. Antonio Brown is back deep for the Mountaineers. Not one of his better efforts. As King shanks this one, it ends up at the 44-yard line. He was averaging 40 yards per punt coming into this game. That one traveling over 15 yards, so the Mountaineers will start with good field position when we come back. ESPN's exclusive presentation of the 2000 Music City Bowl is brought to you by Buick and your local Buick dealers, by Banks, a beer apart, and by Morgan Stanley Dean Witter. Move your money, get well connected. Mark Jones, Gino Toretta, Rob Stone here at Adelphia Coliseum. That is Wes Hours on first down and 10 for the Mountaineers on its first possession of the ball game. Hours powering forward for a couple of yards. When I say powering, I'm not joking. That's a 290-pound fullback. Meanwhile, Brad Lewis is the starting quarterback, a 6'3", 220-pound junior, completing 48% of his passes, but he has gotten better in the last 3 games after getting over a hand injury. Second down and 7. The give is to Avon Coburn. And he is stopped up after a gain of about 2 on the play by Derek Burgess. Here's a look at the skill positions. Corey Ivory, a dangerous receiver.
Ivy, 39 straight games with a catch. Antonio Brown, really the speedster, sub 4.2 speed. Look for West Virginia to get him the football.
Third down, and about 6 to go. Lewis to pass, had his receiver, and it's incomplete, intended for Phil Braxton, and there's a flag on the play. It was broken up by Justin Coleman.
I think Justin Coleman just got there, Mark, just a tad early. Maybe got a hand on the back.
Pass interference.
on the defense. Spot foul. First down.
Here you see just man coverage. Coleman in bump and run, a curl route. And there you see the bump right before the ball gets there. Good call by the official. And West Virginia starts off with good field position and then a penalty. Now they're already on the 40-yard line of Ole Miss.
First down and 10 from the 40. Coburn and Hours lining up out of the eye this time. West Virginia likes to pound away. Lewis, though, on the play fake. Wide open, Wes Hours. And he's got room. Touchdown, Mountaineers. Strike by number 40, Wes Hours.
And Mark, the coaches told us Wes Hours at 290 has great hands and good ball skills. Here you see lots of man coverage by Ole Miss, a misdirection, and Brad Lewis hits Hours down the sideline with the strike. And look at the big fella rumble in for a touchdown.
Brow with the extra points. As I mentioned, 40 yards. Gino, you said he had good football moxie, but what about his wheels? Good speed at 290. The big fella shaking it and shaking it fast as West Virginia takes the lead. We'll be right back.
Big fullback Wes Hours puts the Mountaineers up front early at 7-0 early first quarter from the Music City Bowl in Nashville, Tennessee. Well, we know this is Don Nayland's final contest as a head coach here at WVU, and we're going to be tracking them all game. And this first opening series, well, you know, we see a lot of older coaches who are kind of detached. Not Nayland today. He has been working the sidelines before kickoff and during it. When that touchdown pass was completed, the first one QB Brad Lewis ran up to, head coach Don Nayland was right there to give him a hug and a little whisper in his ear. Don Nayland is working this game. He's intent. He's fired up, and his players are feeding off of it.
Yeah, you know, thanks a lot, Rob. They have talked all week about trying to win it for their coach, along with winning it for themselves, and in the process trying to snap that 8-game bowl losing streak. Off to an auspicious beginning here. 9:27 to play in the first quarter. Todd James kicking off for the Mountaineers. Back deep, it's McAllister and Williams for Ole Miss. West Virginia 6-5 overall on the season. Another deep kickoff into the end zone. And for the second consecutive time, Ole Miss will start off on its own 20-yard line. Don Nayland has been the head coach for 21 seasons at West Virginia. He says he's tried so many different methods of trying to snap out of their bowl funk. They've lost 8 consecutive bowl games. He says he's tried everything from kissing them to almost killing them, Gino.
You know what, though? He's had lots of success. Only 17 coaches ever to get 200 wins in Division I football.
Sanford and McAllister lining up out of the eye. This is Deuce. Couldn't get to the edge that time. Stopped right near the line of scrimmage by Jason Davis, number 90, making his second tackle of the ball game.
And Mark, West Virginia has given McAllister nowhere to run with the football.
That's supposed to be illegal, isn't it, Gino?
I believe so. I believe they completely made a rule outlawing that exact act.
Yep. Both teams a little geeked up right now here in the first quarter. Second down and 10. Miller to pass. Complete underneath to Collins. Chris Collins has the first down for Ole Miss. Rick Sherrod, the free safety, making the stop. But Collins is a dangerous receiver, number 8 right there. He's one of the speed guys, and he's a former high school track and field champion in the 100 and 200 meters.
And sub 4.4 speed, he's their third receiver, but the coaches are very high on him, Mark. You know what, though, going back to Coach Nealon, 8 bowl losses in a row. You know what, you have to get to a bowl game to have a bowl loss.
Got
so, I mean,
point.
We still have to credit the success he's had in the regular season just to get to a bowl game.
First down and 10 for the Rebels. Miller on the waggle, close to the first down. roughed up out of bounds by Sean Hackett, the strong safety, and we have a player down at the 43-yard line, a West Virginia player.
And Mark, we talked about the senior leadership of Romero Miller. He takes a play-action fake. There's nowhere to go with the football. He tucks it down, gets upfield. There, I think that was questionable, maybe a little bit of unnecessary roughness, but the official didn't feel so.
Meanwhile, still trying to identify the injured player for the Mountaineers. Nose of the ball now resting on the 47-yard line. Don't forget, folks, coming up, it's the Pittsburgh Panthers against Iowa State at 7:30 Eastern Time, 4:30 Pacific, from Bank One Ballpark in Phoenix, Arizona. Antonio Bryant, an All-American out of Pittsburgh, is coming off its most successful season that team is in the last 11 years. Iowa State, meanwhile, finishing the regular season 8-3, its best in 22 seasons, led by a running back, Ennis Haywood. Both teams extremely emotional today for different reasons. Lewis, Hours, both with a common denominator, winning one for their head coach, and this is final appearance.
And Mark, this injury timeout, Antoine Lake, their defensive tackle, the coaches felt they really need him. He had an ankle injury earlier in the season, but they need him to play big to clog up that middle and not give McAllister any creases to run with the football.
And now nice to see Lake get up under his own power. As you mentioned, talking about him, he's from Cambridge, Maryland. He switched actually from defensive end last year, moved inside. And,
that's a tough move, Mark. He has to bulk up, and now he's getting double teamed inside instead of trying to speed rush around the end.
Got those centers and guards pounding on you. First down and 10 for Ole Miss. This is Joe Gunn, who switches up the tempo a little bit when it's not Deuce McAllister. Gunn is a 5'10", 200-pound junior out of Armory, Mississippi. Made starts against Kentucky and UNLV and Georgia because of various injuries to McAllister this year, and he compliments Deuce pretty well.
Compliments him, and he's a more than adequate backup for Joe Gunn. Ole Miss is going to miss McAllister when he leaves, but Gunn is going to be able to fill McAllister's shoes as best he can.
Second down and 4 for Ole Miss. Flag down, a little movement in the backfield. Pass is complete to L.J. Taylor out near the 36-yard line. Talked about Deuce's various accomplishments during his tenure at Ole Miss. Look at those numbers. Several school records. He has tied or equaled 18 different school records at Mississippi, Gino.
And he is probably the best and most talented all-purpose player in college football today. I know the pro scouts are drooling over him. He's a great kick returner, punt returner, running back. He can do it all.
Considered one of the top seniors in the upcoming NFL draft in April. Second down and 9. Complete over the middle. And a first down to the 30-yard line to Jamie Armstrong. And let's go back to Chris Fowler with an update from the studio.
Yeah, Mark, humanitarian bowl. Boise State trying to win on its home field. Already leading in the third quarter. Brock Forsey rips off the run here early fourth quarter. That made it 31-13. UTEP just kicked the field goal, but the margin is still 15. Back to you guys.
All right, thanks a lot, Chris. You know when you see the blue field, Gino, it's Boise State.
No mistaking that field of play.
Yeah, but the birds mistake it. They crash into it. That's a serious problem out there. McAllister and Sanford lining up out of the offset eye. Miller steps back and tries to call a timeout, but there's a flag down.
It's going to be a delay of game, Mark. West Virginia came down to the blitz late.
You know, Gino, one thing we haven't talked about so far is Well, we've talked about it off air because we're all bundled up with our mittens and jackets, but it's very cold down there. Who does that favor if one team or another? Does it?
Well, I think it would favor West Virginia. Coach Nealon told us, hey, it was a cold week of practice, snowing, and I think the cold weather definitely favors West Virginia here, but I don't think it's going to be much of a factor. This field's in great condition.
10 degrees with the wind chill. This is Towered Sanford. Down to the 31-yard line. We're here at Adelphia Coliseum in Nashville, Tennessee for the Music City Bowl, the first ever meeting between Ole Miss out of the SEC and West Virginia out of the Big East. I'm Mark Jones along with Gino Toretta and Rob Stone down on the sidelines. It is 7-0 West Virginia taking the lead on a 40-yard pass and run. Lewis to Wes Hours. Second down and 11. Miller complete. Down to the 19-yard line. Again, it's Chris Collins, the freshman speedster, finding a crease in that zone.
Mark, we talked about Ole Miss. As their quarterback Miller goes, they go. McAllister's a great player, but the offensive line's giving him all the time to throw. He finds Collins, the freshman, for another first down. Miller is off to a great start here today.
That is the second catch today for Chris Collins, the freshman. Davis making his third tackle. Quite a bit downfield. First down and 10, just inside the 20-yard line. Nothing doing that time. Number 28, Joe Gunn, shot down at the 20-yard line, right near the line of scrimmage. The charge led by David Carter and Grant Wiley.
Carter has been one of their very vocal players about the coaching change in that situation. But he comes up, Gunn tries to make the spin, and there Carter meets him face to face and said, sorry, Joe, you're not going anywhere.
Here's Miller to pass. Myers incomplete. And it'll be second down and third down and 10. Check that. And speaking of David Carter, who made the tackle on the last play, he came back from ACL injury in 98, and he talked about getting a monkey off his back.
Basically, I think everybody we come down here try to get this monkey off our back. For some reason, West Virginia has been to about 13 bowl games and never won one. So basically, we come down here to handle business and try to get this monkey off our back.
Looks like he means business, Gino. Third down and 10 for the Rebels. This is the 10th play of the drive. Miller complete. And a first down at the 6-yard line. A nice post run by Grant Hurd, number 88.
And another great throw by Miller. But going back to that comment by David Carter, hey, 13, it's only 8 bowl losses in a row.
It just felt like 13.
It feels like 13 to the West Virginia fans. But I tell you what, Miller is having a great day here. We haven't even mentioned McAllister much. He's had a couple carries, not a lot of yards. But there you see, lost the last 8 bowl games, and this would be a great victory and last victory for Don Naylor.
Right now, though, it's the Rebels with the ball at the 6. McAllister back in the ball game. Runs over Vincent and Johnson, stopped up after about a gain of a yard. It'll be second and goal. Wiley and Caden making the stop on the play for the Mountaineers. Look at what Ole Miss has done at the red zone this year. That's pretty proficient.
Very proficient, Mark. They're 87% red zone scoring. That's the second in their conference in the SEC. So when they get down here inside the 20, they know what to do with the football. They don't have any senseless penalties, and they make sure they score.
Discipline has been one of their signatures this year. McAllister now in motion. Up the middle and stopped up is Sanford. Met right up the gut by Kyle Caden, the middle linebacker from Fremont, Ohio. And it'll be third down and goal. Nose of the ball on the 2.
Let's see. Rushing, receiving, punt return. even threw for a touchdown.
That's right, in the last game against Mississippi State.
That last play, they used him as a decoy. They motioned him out and hit Samford right up the gut of the fullback.
Third and goal. The toss. The two stopped up short. The Mountaineer defense responding big time. Hackett leading the charge.
Duke McAllister, these first couple drives for Ole Miss, has been more effective as a decoy than he has the threat when he gets the football. He takes the toss, and the big safety, Sean Hackett, comes up and makes the play. Look at West Virginia swarm.
And a look of dejection and disappointment from the Ole Miss coaches upstairs here. Into attempt the field goal now is Les Binkley. Out of the hold of Ben Craddock. And Binkley knocks it through. Now 10 of 14 on the season, and there's a flag down in the play.
Looks to be against West Virginia, Mark. Yard running into the kicker, so it's not going to be enough for the first down. We'll have to see if Coach Cutcliffe takes the penalty and goes for it on fourth down. I don't believe he's going to take points off the board here.
5 yards running into the kicker against the defense. The penalty is refused. The field goal is good.
Do you know what would be Coach Cutcliffe's reason for not taking those points off the board? That's something we'll talk about when we come back. 1:51 to play. Binkley putting the Rebels on the board. And it's 7-3 when we come back.
Well, we want to wish everybody across the country Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, Happy Holiday from the Ole Miss Rebels. Come to Oxford anytime to see us. You'll get plenty of holiday spirit and hospitality.
Well, I want to wish everyone Merry Christmas and Happy New Year's, and I hope your holidays are very successful.
I wish everyone who's out there, know who's not here in Nashville, a happy holidays and a Happy New Year.
Well, thank you, and a Happy New Year to you guys, too. A belated Merry Christmas. West Virginia with a 7-3 lead. Those guys definitely not the Body by Jake crew. I'm not sure how they keep warm because it is frigid down there on the field with the wind chill. It is 10 degrees Fahrenheit. Sean Terry and Antonio Brown back deep. On with Phil Braxton, number 21, and kicking off is Ole Miss. A short kick. All the way to the 23. Braxton. Nice return by the Mountaineer out to the 45-yard line. And for the second consecutive time after this 22-yard return, they start off with good field position. Take a look at that offensive line, how they started. The Becks starting lineup for West Virginia. That is a big, powerful offensive line, Gino.
In the center, Rick Gilliam. All-American farm team, and I know our colleague down on the field would like to mention that.
They have a distinct size advantage over these guys up front for Ole Miss as they go just 265, 272, 255, and 240 across the defensive front. Coburn and Hours, this is Coburn. Out near midfield, gain of about 5 on the play. Stopped up by Ken Lucas. Let's take a look at the linebacking crew. Cook, Johnson, and Williams.
And lots of shuffling around, Mark. You're going to see lots of man coverage by Ole Miss. Their experience is their defensive ends and their cornerbacks. So West Virginia is probably going to try to attack, run the football inside.
Ken Lucas on the corner there, number 24, is one of the top corners in the country. Expected to be a first-round pick in the April draft. Motion on the left side of the offensive line for the Mountaineers. Matt Wilson, number 71. Moments ago, we referred to the size advantage that Ole Miss has. Actually, West Virginia has on the offensive line. 316 on average to 283.
besides size, like I said, Mark, Ole Miss very inexperienced. They lost their nose guard and defensive tackle from a season ago and a very good linebacker. They're inexperienced in their front seven. Look for West Virginia to just pound the ball, especially when you have a fullback that's 290 pounds blocking.
That would be the West Express, but here they throw it. Corey Ivey complete at the 42-yard line. Ivey, the 6'3 senior out of Boca Raton, Florida. He has now caught a pass in 40 consecutive games.
And Mark, you mentioned Ken Lucas, Ole Miss, one of their top corners. Well, that catch, Corey Ivey's on Justin Coleman. So West Virginia being very wise with the football and throwing away from Ken Lucas.
Rebels like to play a lot of man defense. Lewis hands it off to Coburn, who stopped up at the line of scrimmage. Right at the 45 this time. Gothy making the stop. As the final seconds tick off here in the first quarter, in the first meeting between West Virginia and Ole Miss. And the big play of the game so far came courtesy of number 14 and a 40-yard pass to number 40. The West Express took it to the house. 7-3 when we come back to Nashville. A benevolent sky and the sun setting here in Nashville, Tennessee. Ole Miss against West Virginia. The Mountaineers with the lead, and that man, the head coach, Don Nealon, in his last game as head coach at West Virginia. This is his swan song in the Music City. A look at his accomplishments. 338 games. That's a long time. I don't know, Gino, if we're ever going to see the time where one coach stays at one school for that long.
You will if you have the winning percentage. He's still over 60% in all those years of coaching. He's done an outstanding job wherever he's been, here in Bowling Green.
And the business has changed and evolved quite a bit. Second down and 11. Lewis to pass. Has the man wide open. First down and a catch by Antonio Brown. I mean, he was wide open. Dinnaker Taylor finally making the tackle.
Mark, I tell you what, this ball's underthrown. Watch Brown up top. At the top of his route, he makes a great stick move. He fakes to the outside right there, and look at that post. He's wide open there in the middle of the field, and Lewis underthrows the football. That's 6 points. All he's got to do is get that ball out there and let Brown run with it. We talked about the speed, and there he showed. Now he has some moves to go with it.
Brown with sub 4.2 speed in the 40. That's quicker than Gossip, folks. There's Coburn up the middle. And he is stopped up at the 10-yard line. Gino, we were talking about number 14 right there during the break, Brad Lewis. He looks today much better than his statistics on the year so far.
Well, coaches feel he has been this healthy, I think, since the second game of this season. He had a banged-up thumb, thought he could play through it. But he played the majority of the season where he couldn't even really feel his throwing hand. I'm not sure how you can throw like that as a quarterback, but hey, he still did a good job of it.
That can be problematic. Look at his season stats. Second down and 9. Brown in motion. Lewis. Ivey, touchdown. Second for Stickham. Yards, but what a catch by Corey Ivey.
And Mark, how many times do we see this? Ole Miss comes into this football game. They want to play lots of man coverage. Lewis recognizes the man coverage. Ivey on the drag route, the one-handed grab. A very well-executed play.
The second touchdown pass of the day for Brad Lewis, the quarterback. The extra point is good, and Don Nalen's team trying to send him off on a high note in the Music City. Lewis playing crazy.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of the 2000 Music City Bowl is presented by Sonic, America's favorite drive-in, and their friends at Dr. Pepper are proud sponsors of the 2000 Music City Bowl, and in part by Dodge, the nearly 3,000 dealers who invite you to come see what's different. Let's go downstairs to Rob Stone, who has a man who has a vested interest in this team.
There's an understatement for you. Rich Rodriguez, the new head coach of West Virginia University. I think you're enjoying this game so far. Is that an understatement?
Yeah, I'm really excited. We're playing really well, and I'm happy for the coaches and the team. It looked like they've been focused to come here and play well, and so far it's going out great.
This has to be a bittersweet moment for you. You played under Coach Nalen. You're the man who has to take his team from him. What's going through your head right now?
Well, I'm just hoping that they play well for him in his last ball game. I know it means a lot to him, and that it would send him off with a great retirement present, and I know he wants this game very badly.
Stay tight, Coach. We've got more for you.
All right, Rob, we'll get back to you in just a minute. Deuce McAllister, meanwhile, brought down at the 21-yard line. Let's go back to Rob.
I guess one of the biggest difficulties you've been having since taking over is filling up your coaching staff. How's that coming along, and I guess why the delays?
Well, obviously, with the NCAA limit, you don't have one coaching staff on at one time, so it's forced me to take my time, which has been good in a way because I want to take my time anyway, because it's probably the most important decisions I make in my tenure here is going to be my coaching staff. So I've taken my time. I have a couple hires already, and then after the bowl season, I'll finish up my staff.
All right, let's go to the action. Hold on, Coach.
All right, Rob, first down and 10 from the 21 for Ole Miss. McAllister for a loss of about two. Coach Rodriguez has to like that D, Rob.
You're enjoying the D, I know you are, but how are you enjoying the recruiting trail? That has to be your main focus right now.
Yeah, the first couple weeks in December, I was kind of on the road myself a good bit and got a chance to visit some prospects. I think the reception has been great. I think we have a lot to offer West Virginia University as far as our program, our great fans, and the things we can do with our West Virginia football. So I'm excited. I think it'll go great for us.
After this game, this team officially becomes yours. Are you going to speak to them after the game or give them some time and let it be Coach Nalen's moment?
No, I'm going to let it strictly be Coach Nalen's moment. It's his football team all the way until this game is over, and then after the game as well. And then I'll take over in the 1st of January.
Coach, thanks for your time. Good luck with the Mountaineers.
Thank you. Stay warm.
All right. Thanks a lot, Rob and Coach Rodriguez. Meanwhile, McAllister out to the 35-yard line, busting one for a first down. And Rich Rodriguez runs that wide-open offense that they have down in Clemson and the same one they use down in Tulane, Gino. Should be entertaining, if nothing else, next year.
Entertaining. They're going to throw the ball a lot more, a very fast break style of offense.
And there's the man whose shoes he will be filling
and who taught him a lot of what he knows, a former player for Don Nealon.
First down and 10 from the 35-yard line for Ole Miss. McAllister again. They've got him solved and stuffed up so far in the ballgame, a loss of about one. Let's go back downstairs to Rob.
Well, guys, Big has been better for years on the O-line for West Virginia. No more. Rich Rodriguez, he wants to streamline his big boys so they can better handle his new up-tempo offense he hopes to employ. Now, the upcoming Jenny Craig experience has some of the 300-plus pounders worried about dropping around 265. This will not be an anorexic line, but rather a more athletic collection of players. But regardless, now maybe those kickers can get their share at the training table.
Ah, thank you, Rob.
Implying that maybe the kickers didn't make it, or the bigger guys kind of kept them out of it.
Miller, meanwhile, complete. Out to the 42-yard line. Number 14, L.J. Taylor. He'll be about 2 yards short of the first down. Rick Sherrod, the free safety, and Hackett making the tackle on the play.
Once again, the offensive line giving Miller all the time in the world to throw. There you see Taylor, just a simple hook and lat hook play, and Miller's putting the ball right on the money. He's hitting his receivers in between the numbers, Mark.
Third down and 3. The passing game hasn't been the problem for Ole Miss. It's been the running attack so far. Third and 2. Miller, complete to the fullback, Sanford, who has the first down near midfield on the Mountaineer side of midfield at the 49-yard line. Number 6, Howard Sanford, the 5'10", sophomore. And a 67-yard touchdown reception against Tulane, so that's a role they use him in often. He can catch the ball out of the backfield.
Mark, I'm I'm sure Steve Dunlap, the defensive coordinator for West Virginia, felt, hey, let's make Ole Miss one-dimensional. We'll stop McAllister from letting Miller throw the football. I'm not sure that's too wise of a decision because they're a very balanced offense.
And they give it to Miller up the middle. Gains about two. McAllister runs it up the middle, and as I said, he had scored 17 touchdowns this year. That's tops in the SEC. Lake making the stop on the play. Hey, don't forget, folks, coming up, you won't want to miss this. Saturday, December 30th, part one at 4:30 Eastern Time, 1:30 Pacific. Next year is now. This football show focuses on a Pennsylvania high school football team, the North Penn Knights, in a year where they feel they can win it all. They go behind the scenes in that, and you see some pretty compelling and riveting video. Let's go back to the last drive by the Mountaineers, one that was capped by an Ivy touchdown. This was the big play. Antonio Brown, and that was the touchdown pass to Ivy.
And Mark, Ole Miss gambled there. They brought the blitz. Ivy catches the touchdown.
Poison Ivy for Ole Miss. We'll be right back. Here's a look at the last drive. Lewis with some key plays, getting up off the turf to make some big passes, and the emotional last drive. What is really the telling story here? You know what? One of the things, Gino, was they wanted to come out and win it for the coach.
And look at that. Build to a crescendo. It's Nayland's the last game. Ole Miss, 22 bars means Duke McAllister. Use him, whether he's a decoy or get him the ball.
McAllister comes out of the backfield, but Miller goes the other way. And Miller is pushed out of bounds at the 46-yard line. Back to the studio and Chris Fowler.
Well, in Boise, UTEP had cut it to 8 and forced a punt. Then they fumbled the punt, and Boise may have put this away. Andre Banks with a throwback to Bart Hendricks. The quarterback has thrown for one, run for two, and caught a touchdown pass, showing Toretta-like toughness. The margin back to 15.
Wow, Chris, a new standard in the toughness department, Gino. You're just setting high water marks, huh?
It's a nice plug, Chris.
It's a Christmas present, right? Third down and 7 for the Rebels. Miller fires a dart, incomplete. Sean Hackett knocks it away. Intended for Taylor. And there's a flag down on the play. Is against the Mountaineers, so it'll be an automatic first down on the pass interference. Ball in the 35,
and it will continue this drive. Don Nealon doesn't like that call. It was a drag route, crossing route, and it looked like the West Virginia defender was able to get his hand without touching the wide receiver, but the official saw it different.
...10-13 to play in the first half. Underneath, complete, down to the 31-yard line. And let's go back as Ziegler makes the catch.
There you see the drag route coming across the middle, and there Hackett, the safety, comes from behind. I think that's a great play by the safety, Hackett, Mark.
One of the toughest calls in all of football, pass interference call. Philadelphia Coliseum is where we are. Music City Bowl. In Nashville, Tennessee, I'm Mark Jones along with Gino Toretta and Rob Stone. West Virginia University leading 14-3, and this is the last final game for their head coach, Don Nealon. As Howard Sanford making it to the 30-yard line, brought down by Caden Upchurch. Caden is a three-year starter for the Mountaineers, one of the smartest players on their defensive unit.
Tackled by number 45.
And Mark, he's one of the team captains in Don Nealon's career. I think he's only had three or four juniors actually be captains for his ball club. Tells you the kind of respect that Coach Nealon has for Kyle Caden and his play and leadership.
Third down and four to go. They've converted three out of four times in third down situations today. Incomplete, intended for L.J. Taylor. And that was one of the few errant throws today by Miller. Let's go downstairs to Rob.
West Virginia trainers about Grant Wiley, the freshman linebacker. It's his left knee that they're examining right now. He's up and kind of hobbling around trying to walk it off. They said there's a contusion on the inside of his knee, but his knee is stable. But he's also complaining of some ankle problems right now. They list him as questionable.
All right, thanks a lot, Rob. He's a key on their defensive unit. Binkley now in to attempt a field goal from 47 yards out. He has a long of 41 this year, so this would be a season best for him. And he got it. Just barely squeezed it over the upright. Much to the delight of the head coach. As Mississippi pulls a little bit closer on the second field goal of the day by Les Binkley. Keep in mind, Binkley is a big-time kicker. Last year in their Independence Bowl game, he kicked the game winner in the dying seconds of that contest. One more look where less is more. 14-6 when we come back to Nashville. The sun setting here in Nashville, Tennessee. West Virginia leading 14-6 with 8:41 to play in the first half. Ole Miss set to kick off. Terry and Braxton back deep for West Virginia. And Terry has returned one this year. Actually, he's returned a couple. One of 100 yards, another of 89.
And this one's returnable.
This is Terry. And pushed out of bounds at the 28-yard line. Let's go downstairs to Rob Stone, who has a special guest.
That's right, Mark. We're joined now by Butch Spiridon, the vice president, the executive vice president of the Nashville Convention Visitors Bureau. This is Music City, USA, but starting to become Football Town, USA, isn't it?
Well, Music City Bowl, Tennessee Titans, playoffs, hopefully an AFC championship game. Yeah, we're feeling our way through football world.
I was talking to you earlier. What is the best thing about a bowl game coming into a city, outside of all that money that comes in?
Well, certainly the dollars are why you get into it in the first place. But when you take care of the players, like I think we do, and give them a memory to live with for the rest of their lives, and then you take care of the fans and everybody goes away feeling good about the city, and then the city gets behind it. So it's just an excellent experience for us, and hey, we have as much fun as everybody else.
Hey, thanks for your time. Stick close. I got to get some dinner recommendations from you.
Thanks. Enjoy it.
All right, Rob. Yeah, did a couple restaurants, actually. Antonio Brown pushed out of bounds near the 33-yard line by Sean Johnson, the middle linebacker. Brown, you saw a display of some of his speed right there. He's the fastest member of that West Virginia team. Coach Nealon calls him our keg of TNT, dynamite.
And Bill Legg, the offensive coordinator for West Virginia, he told us, hey, we need to throw some crossing routes, lots of misdirection because of the man coverage by Ole Miss.
They have mixed up their play selection well so far. Coburn and Hours out of the eye. This is Coburn. Avon Coburn. Coburn with a huge gain down to the 35-yard line in Rebel territory. Finally pushed out of bounds by Anthony McGee. Coburn out of Cherry Hill, New Jersey. Second team All Big East.
Watch the blocking up front. There you see Dixon, the guard, comes up. Hours makes a key block, and Coburn, only a sophomore, had 1,100 yards rushing last year as a freshman, and he's going for 1,000 here in this ball game.
Picked up 33 on that scamper. Down to the 35-yard line. First down and 10. Mountaineers moving the chains again. Hours in motion. Cuts. Lewis has a man open. Touchdown, Brown! 35 yards to Pater.
You know what, Mark? How many bowl games have we seen? There's extra time in preparing. A team puts in a new wrinkle. Ole Miss runs man coverage.
They cannot cover Antonio Brown. I don't care who it is playing defense. They can't cover him. There's Coach Nealon. Hey, don't get too excited. It's still early in the ball game here.
Brendan Rodgino with the extra point. And the interesting thing to note on that last touchdown catch is that Lewis to Brown, that combination victimized Kent Lucas, the big-time DB. We'll be right back after this.
He's always been real good to me and very helpful. The door's always been open. Been very good to my family. You know, this has been probably one of the best things that ever happened to me the past 5 years, and that all comes back to Coach Nealon. So for that, I'll probably always be in his, you know, his debt.
Thoughtful words on his head coach, Don Nealon. And Nealon right now leading 21-6. This is final game as head coach at West Virginia. Todd James kicking off for the Mountaineers. Back deep, McAllister and Williams. West Virginia has kicked the deuce in check so far. This is Williams. Still on his feet. How many times do you see it where a fumbled kickoff leads to a good return like that? All the way out to the 42-yard line. One more look, though, back at that last touchdown pass.
You see Antonio Brown up top. He's man for man, Kent Lucas. But watch the juke move by Brown. He gets inside. Anytime a defensive back is playing man coverage, he's got to take the inside away, make the wide receiver go outside. Brown shows a little bit of juke move, gets inside. 6 points, Mark.
And look at the four big plays that they've had today. A total of 143 yards. Haven't used much clock either. Gunn with a gain of about three. Let's go back to Chris in the studio. We're going to get to Chris in just a bit. Rewinding the tape back in baseline. Second down and seven. Hackett in on the last stop. Stackhouse and McAllister out of the eye. Miller on what appears to be a busted play. Brought down at the 42-yard line by David Carter out of Philadelphia, PA.
And Mark, I know it's early in this ball game. Here you see the broken play. Miller ready to throw the football. His wide receiver's not looking. But it's early. Ole Miss definitely has to put some points on the board with this drive. They're already down 21-6. West Virginia's only had the ball 5 minutes in this ball game. I tell you what, they need points this drive.
Miller fires a dart complete over the middle to Jamie Armstrong, who has a first down for the Rebels at the Mountaineers 43-yard line. Rick Sherrod, the free safety, making the tackle on the play.
And in zone coverage, what happens? There's going to be creases, and Ole Miss has done a good job. Here you see up top is the wide receiver. Just runs a simple curl route to the inside. Look at that. Wide open. That's where you want to hit a zone. You want to hit in the creases in between the linebackers and in front of the safeties. And Miller, I tell you what, he's very accurate today. He's only missed one throw thus far this game.
Little play fake by Miller. Stands poised. Fires another complete pass at the 30-yard line to L.J. Taylor, who took a lick but held on to it. Hey, big day of college football coming up tomorrow. Starting at 1:30 Eastern time, it's Colorado State against Louisville in the AXA Liberty Bowl, then the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl, LSU against Georgia Tech in that one, and then it's the Culligan Holiday Bowl, number 12, Texas against number 11, Oregon. Big triple dip tomorrow on ESPN. First down and 10 for Ole Miss with 5:41 to play in the first half. This is Joe Gunn.
Dunn with a nice burst. Inside the 10, it'll be first and goal for Ole Miss. Hackett making a touchdown-saving tackle. West Virginia comes with the blitz. They bring the corner. They're going to gamble. But watch the blocking up front. Gunn takes the handoff. Look at the alley. He just sees that, cuts up. There you see the burst of speed. He's able to run through one tackle and get that ball inside the 10-yard line. And here you go, Mark. They're inside the 20 in the red zone. They're very effective when they get down in there.
First down and goal. Rayford in motion. It's Gunn again. This time running over the right side over Bryson Metcalf. Stopped up after a gain of about two on the play. Kyle Caden in on the stop. Caden, a real pillar in the middle. A three-year starter.
Well, Mark, I'm wondering if McAllister may still be a little banged up because Gunn's getting a lot of playing time early in the ball game. You'd think with the rest before a bowl game, he'd be healthy, especially early.
Yeah, they haven't played since Thanksgiving, pretty much, against Mississippi State. Second and goal. Intended for Hurd, incomplete. The timing appeared to be just a bit off. Lance Frazier in on the coverage.
Well, that's a new route. What Hurd's doing, it's running a fade stop, it's called. And all Miller's doing, he's throwing the ball at the defender's backside of his helmet, and Hurd tries to stop and make the catch. It's a very, very tough throw to complete.
Third down and eight. Third and goal from the eight. Incomplete again. This one intended for Collins. And it'll be fourth down and goal. And in comes the field goal unit.
Four wide receivers all slant. There you see Miller. He throws that low. That's another great throw right on target. Collins just can't come up with the catch. I think it was just the distraction by Frazier of blocking his vision. Couldn't see the ball.
And as a result, Binkley comes in to attempt his third field goal of the day. He's already made two, one from 23 and another from 47. This one coming from 26. And he's good again. So Binkley has accounted for all of David Cutcliffe's offense today. And with 4:22 to play in a very emotional game, West Virginia leads 21-9. We'll be right back.
West Virginia with a 21-9 lead. That's a good look at Brad Lewis, the starting quarterback for West Virginia University. Now, when the offense is not out in the field, he's placing this on his right hand. What it is a hydrocolated heat pad. Now, during the season, he suffered what they call an RSD. It's a trauma-induced poor blood supply. He hit his hand on a helmet. Hence, he experiences a lot of numbness and lack of feeling in his throwing hand. So what they do is they take that hydrocolated heat pad, which is a moist heat pack, and place it on his hand in these cold games. They found that's worked very well for him. One other little injury update, if you will. Freshman linebacker Grant Wiley of the Mountaineers was taken into the locker room. They are x-raying his fibula. No reports quite yet.
All right. Thanks a lot, Rob. And, yeah, see if you can...
You need that heat pack. You know, five for three touchdowns. You have the ball for 5 minutes. He's got to stay warm on the sidelines. Every time he gets on, he throws a touchdown.
I want to wear that the entire game. 5 for 5, as you mentioned, 131 yards total passing.
Wouldn't mind a couple of those up here in the booth, huh, Jones?
Not at all. For our feet, too. Binkley might be wearing one on his right foot. He's accounted for all 9 points. And Ole Miss, look at the plays, 40 of them to just 12 for West Virginia, but the only numbers that count are the ones on the scoreboard. And Binkley can't believe that he kicked it out of bounds.
And once again, gives West Virginia great field position. That's what Ole Miss, they haven't been able to pin West Virginia back and make them drive a long way.
Bowers and Coburn lining up out of the eye with 4:16 to play in the first half. Avon Coburn gets to the edge, gets a good block from Ivy. A well-designed and executed flat-out play and a first down for the Mountaineers. Gothie finally making the tackle, but a flag down on the play.
Watch this. Fake dive to Ours. Toss to Coburn on the back. Watch the block there by Corey Ivey. Look at that. Getting upfield. I think he's getting called for the holding. But Rob mentioned it early in the show. Hey, Coach Nealon, throw out the playbook. He's throwing every play over his 30-year coaching career that's worked in the past. And you know what? They all seem to be working today.
They sure are. The old fox, Don Nealon, out of West Virginia University, 21 years at all. And this is his final game as head coach. First and five. Backside pressure. It's complete to Brown. What a block he got. Touchdown, Brown. Ivy delivered a block that sprung him loose for the final 15 yards. Yards in all, and another big play on the arm of Brad Lewis. You see the play action fake by Coburn. Another crossing route to their speedster Antonio Brown. And Corey Ivey comes back and delivers a deep-leader blow to Ken Lucas.
Now that one wasn't holding. That one was definitely not holding.
Yes, Don Nealon can feel it. His team leading 28-9. And one more look at that touchdown pass and run.
There you see the motion across by Brown, and he's just coming stricken dead across the field. Lewis makes him, does not make him break stride. There's the block out of the corner of the screen, and Brown able to tightrope down the sidelines. Once again, let's just watch this. This is poetry in motion. Brown showing his speed to get upfield. A nice little juke, able to get in. Antonio Brown, 22% of West Virginia's offense this season, and he's showing why.
Brad Lewis and the rest of the offense and the rest of the defense, for that fact, psyched up, trying to respond, trying to write a few stanzas, a few bars of sweet music for their head coach to ride into the sunset in. Look at that, 5.1 yards per play on first down.
15 touchdowns on first down this season. All four today have been on first down.
28 points with just under 4 minutes to play in the first half. But Don Nealon is pressing all the right buttons and pulling all the right strings and writing all the correct notes. It's a real symphony so far for the Mountaineers. James kicking off. McAllister and Williams back deep. This one out of bounds at the 22-yard line, and let's go downstairs to Rob.
Well, guys, as positive as things are on the West Virginia side, it is the complete polar opposite on the Ole Miss side. Players spending most of their time just huddling around the heaters, and then starting split end Grant Hurd. I'm walking by. He is in a nasty verbal confrontation with one of his coaches, finger pointing, swearing at one another. This team right now is a rattled bunch of rebels.
Yeah, they've been rattled by the big plays.
And this may be a statement game for Coach Nealon, for the rest of his staff, saying, hey, these guys can put together a great game plan. They've done it here.
Amid all the distractions, amid all the turmoil, amid all the controversy, they've come out and made a huge statement. McAllister stuffed up, and that play right there has been typical, has been symptomatic of the type of day that McAllister and the offense for the Rebels have had so far today. Corey McIntyre making the tackle.
You have to credit West Virginia defense, because it seems every time number 22, Duke McAllister, touches the football, they are completely swarming him and not giving him anywhere to run with the football.
Miller, meanwhile, is 10 of 15 passing. And you think maybe he's a little frustrated too? Could be getting there if he's not already, Gino.
I'm sure he is. Anybody, a player of his caliber, he wants to be able to just give him a crease and he can go.
Second and long. Miller picked off. Rick Sherrod. And the Mountaineers threatening again, this time from the 29.
Has had success running the curl, running the crossing route. Well, they went to the well too many times because there's a curl route, and there you see the safety, Sherrod, just step right in front of the receiver. He anticipates the throw by Miller. It's a key interception. Here you see the safety. He's not buying it. He just bites in front of the receiver. And Rick Sherrod picks up his third interception on the season. That's 20 for the secondary of West Virginia this season.
Little play fake. Lewis up top for Ivy. Complete at the 3-yard line. First and goal, West Virginia. Brad Lewis is doing surgery on that Mississippi secondary. A 26-yard pickup and another first down. Coleman victimized on the play.
And Mark, you have to credit West Virginia receivers because they're getting wide open. Just a post corner move by Corey Ivy. He fakes out the defender in man coverage. And Brad Lewis has all day back there and he's delivering.
And we have a timeout down on the field. Boy, if I'm West Virginia, I just want to keep the beat coming. Keep the hits coming.
You don't want to go on for halftime. You just want to start the third quarter.
That's exactly. If you're West Virginia, that's exactly what you want to do. And you know, Gino, one of the question marks coming into the game was whether they could formulate the right type of game plan, whether they could put everything together in light of all that's happened over the last month with the coaching controversy. I think the answer is very definitive right now, that the answer is yes, they've done it well.
And there was a twinkle in Bill Legg, the offensive coordinator's eye. He said, hey, we need some misdirection and maybe, you know, some gadget plays. And obviously, all the plays they put in for this game have worked.
One of the big concerns for West Virginia, too, today, coming into the game, their Achilles heel on the whole season, special teams, hasn't even been a factor because of the efficiency of the offense.
Has the special teams been on the field?
I haven't seen them.
The offense haven't been on the field much either, but every time they get on the field, they're scoring.
West Virginia has had six plays of 30 yards or more. Three of them touchdowns today. Lewis, 7 of 7 passing, folks. Dig this, 216 yards with four touchdowns, and they're looking at first and goal from the 4-yard line.
And Mark, West Virginia only averages 27 points a game this season. They already have 28, and it's only the first half.
Coburn, inside. No signal. And he is stopped just short of the end zone. Tough running by number 22.
He takes the toss, and there you see the big fullback Powers in front of him, makes the block. There's a spin. He's fighting for all the yards. I guess his knee came down before the ball crossed the plane of the goal line. That's why the ball is.
We got big number 40 there, 290-pound fullback. Out of the eye, second and goal. No signal. And there was a lot of hard hitting down there. Lanier Gothi came over the top and met ours.
Here you see the fullback Ours takes the ball. I tell you what, Ole Miss took the West Express and turned it around and sent it back for third down.
Said, yeah, you're not ours. You're mine on this one. Third and goal.
I might add, Mark, at 290, I don't think Ours should be jumping to try to go over the top. I think just put your head down and keep your cleats on the ground and you're going in.
Second and goal. Hours again. Touchdown.
What was that comment, Jonesy? Now you're mine.
Exactly.
The West Express is going in. You see, he kept his cleats on the ground and just drive clock right into the end zone. You see the handoff, and Auer just bulldozing his way, breaks the plane of the goal, touchdown, West Virginia.
He is their jack of all trades on offense. He can play, he's played guard on the offensive line. He's played fullback. He's played different positions on the offensive line and defensive end. Defensive end as well. The West Express ready to roll, his second touchdown of the game.
That's about 1,000 pounds the left side of that offensive line, and Wes Auer's coming at you.
Wes Auer's a physical education major from a military background, from a military family, and coaches from West Virginia love it.
Like there was any doubt in their mind, the 290-pound fullback couldn't get in from a half yard out.
That's an XXXXL jersey, isn't it?
I'm sure he needs lots of help getting that jersey on.
Tell you, his relatives are proud of him. We saw them this morning in the hotel room lobby.
And there's plenty of West Virginia fans in front of us, family and friends of Wes Auer. They have the West Express t-shirts on.
They were chanting Wes just moments before he took it into the end zone. Four to play in the first half, and it has been all Don Nealon's West Virginia Mountaineers so far. They came in 6-5 on the season. Some people questioned whether they would be a bowl team, whether they were worthy. I think they've answered a lot of those questions right now. McAllister. He's brought down at the 31-yard line. Let's go back to Chris in the studio.
All right, guys, coming up on the Dodge Difference Halftime Report, Rod Gilmore will join me. We'll have more news on that Sugar Bowl scuffle between the Gators and the Hurricanes. Michael Vick holds a press conference. Is he waffling about his earlier statement about coming back to school and the Mountaineers' arch rivals involved in a bowl game tonight? Pittsburgh will take on Iowa State, guys.
All right, thank you, Chris. And you know, people wondered what kind of tenor West Virginia would come into the game with Geno coming off of that loss against Pitt in their season finale.
Lots of distractions with the coaching staff, but you have to credit all the players and staff for this West Virginia team because they came ready to play.
Stackhouse with the catch up to the 34.
Look at that. Five times West Virginia's touched the football and five scores. Three plays, two plays, and three plays. They don't take a lot. Only six plays. Six plays are on the side, Justin.
They're trying to get back to the sideline in those heaters, I guess.
There must be something in that heater Lewis has on his hand, I think, besides just more.
Second down and five, meanwhile, for Ole Miss. All of their points coming courtesy of Les Binkley. Three field goals, and the Mountaineers are still bringing the wood. L.J. Taylor couldn't hang on to it. Rick Sherrod nailed them just for good measure.
And Coach Nealon told us going into this game, the free safety, Rick Sherrod, and the strong safety, Sean Hackett, probably the hardest hitting tandem of safeties in college football right now. And they could be, with another season, the best tandem, safety tandem in college football.
Third down and five. Hackett, the team's leading tackle, at the strong safety spot. Miller to pass. Out of bounds at the 42, but there's a flag down back at the 32-yard line. Caden pushing Miller out of bounds.
This one's going to come back for holding, Mark.
Well, if David Cutcliffe is going to win his third consecutive bowl game here at Ole Miss, it will take a monumental turnaround at halftime.
Still has 1:35 to play here in the second quarter. Still has all three of his timeouts. I think they should go two-minute drill. There you see Miller 10 for 13 to start, 1 for 5. I think the West Virginia defense is really keyed into the curl route and the crossing route. And these safeties, Sherrod and Hackett, are coming up making big hits on Deuce McAllister.
And Sherrod with an interception that set up that last touchdown for the Mountaineers. Hurd in motion. Miller with all day. Not anymore. Making something out of nothing. Tiptoes out of bounds at the 30-yard line, stopping the clock with 1:25 to play in the first half. Gino, you talked about them going Ole Miss and their coaching staff going into a two-minute mode, hurry-up offense. But there's a lot more to do besides that.
Well, one, they have to stop West Virginia. Five touches and five scores. You know, and I think the big key is how do you cover Antonio Brown? The kid's faster than anybody on this Ole Miss team. How do you stop him?
And Brown that time catching the punt at the 32 and a flag down. It appears as if Mississippi didn't give him the necessary two-yard halo, the space.
Kick catching interference on the kicking team. Five-yard penalty. First down.
There you see Brown, the punt returner for West Virginia, didn't give him the necessary yardage around to make the catch.
West Virginia, the 38-yard line.
Hey, don't forget, folks, coming up on the Dodge Halftime Report, a little Sugar Bowl news. There was a little dust-up between Miami and Florida players down in New Orleans. Michael Vick talking about his situation next year and a preview of the Insight.com Bowl. It's all coming up on the Dodge Halftime Report, and we have a timeout down in the field. You know, Ken Lucas has had a rough day today. He's out of Cleveland, Mississippi, one of the top DBs in the country. And Lucas earlier this week talked about one of his favorite players, and guess who it was?
No, I just wanted to say, you know, you was one of my favorite players, you know, when you was in college, and Miami was one of my favorite teams, and y'all kind of disappointed me, you know, when playing the national championship game going against Alabama, you know, because I had so much, had some high expectations. I just always wanted to play for Miami, but things didn't work out that way. But, you know, I'm just glad you're here. I just got, glad I had an opportunity to meet you.
Gino Toretta getting some mad love from Ken Lucas. Well, what about that? He was really in awe of you.
I'm sure he would want us to be showing that if he was having a good game, not for giving up a couple touchdowns to Antonio Brown. But Ole Miss, known for man coverage. They've done a great job all season of shutting down wide receivers. What is Ole Miss going to do? They're not known for a lot of zone coverage. They don't know how to play zone coverage. So they really have to look to double team, I believe, Antonio Brown and stop him.
Some kind of change you would think would be in order. Lucas had five interceptions and a school record 25 pass breakups this year. Haven't seen much of that today. Coburn, meanwhile, out to the 40-yard line. Lanier Gothy making the tackle. Look at Ole Miss's defense.
Led the SEC in passing efficiency. I'm not sure how they figure that stat, but I tell you what. Look at this. That's the only stat that matters. I don't care. Pass efficiency, run efficiency. It's 35-9, and they're not stopping West Virginia from doing anything. They only average giving up 187 passing yards per game, 47% completion. I think Lewis is 100% so far.
He looks it. Sure looks it. Run it out to the 43 that time is Avon Coburn. Defending Big East Conference rushing champ, stopped up by Josh Cooper on that play. And you, if you were Garth Brooks, seeing as how we're in Music City, you couldn't have written a better song for Don Nealon in the first half in this, his final game. Let's go to Rob.
Coach, if and what do you say to your team? They have got to be playing beyond your expectations.
Well, we've probably been a little lucky, maybe. But this game's not over. They're way too good a football team. So we're going to have to start all over again, I'm sure of that.
What specifically are you going to tell them to work on?
Well, we're making too many big plays. I'd like to have more five-yarders. You know what I mean? Those five-yard plays are more in my comfort zone.
Hey, we thought you were going to be conservative.
Well, this is my last game.
That's a great problem to have if you're a head coach. Don Nealon, his team up 35-9 at the break. Right now, let's go back to the studio.
All right, fellas, that's a happy Don Nealon, because in past bowl games, in that eight-game losing streak in postseason, they're facing an average deficit of 14 points. He doesn't know what to do, being up 26 here. Yeah, they took 17 plays to get five touchdowns.
That's insane.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. You know, but what do you tell Brad Lewis? Who could have predicted that he would have come out that way and thrown the ball like that?
But the thing I do like about what they've done defensively is they have taken Deuce McAllister out of the game and consciously forced Romero Miller to beat them. They've told him to get it done, and Miller hasn't come through for him yet.
You get a touchdown every three plays. You're doing good things. You did say Brad Lewis, if he's healthy, he would be the key. This has been a very different-looking West Virginia team. Coming up at halftime, the